extremist and terrorist cells in their countries and how to deal with these issues. And I think all governments and a lot of my colleagues have suggested that there was a grave need for a private partner in this effort. And the Counter Extremism Project was formed just last September in the United States, always with the belief that if we could bring together a global coalition of partners, all focusing on the core elements of counter-extremism activities, and then ensuring that every local participant and partner used local best practices. Let me give you some examples. The Counter-Extremism Project focuses in three areas. We look into research, develop, and expose financing of extremist groups. We engage in online work where we try to expose those that propagandize, recruit, calls for action, and fundraise. And we also are hoping to spread appropriate narratives where we combat the insidious narratives of those that would seek to harm and kill us. Those are really the top line, if you will, the overarching themes that unite all of us. But in every country, those elements, the practices within those larger goals will be specific. And through our project today, and as we continue to expand globally, we've been talking to partners around the world, we hope that we will provide the architecture to support these efforts. Already we've had enormous success in the United States of America. We've helped knock terror financing cells out of countries. We've engaged in a very rigorous online campaign to dislodge and disrupt those online propagandists that would use the likes of Twitter, Facebook, and others to spread insidious propaganda. And we believe that spreading some of those tactics and goals around the world will be very, very useful. So the best part of this is working with incredible colleagues of great different cultures and backgrounds and countries, and the very many young, smart people who are in this room that are going to do all the hard work, that continue to do the hard work of dealing with what we think is the most important policy issue of our generation, how to deal with the growth of extremism worldwide and around the world. I'll be coordinating this effort, as we have many fine speakers here today, and we'll be engaging in question and answer at the end, and we have some details about some of our events coming up. With that, it's my great pleasure to introduce Senator Joseph Lieberman, who's been a great friend and colleague, and somebody incredibly distinguished in the United States. Really doesn't need an introduction, but it's my great pleasure to introduce him. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Wallace. I can't resist, because anytime anyone says I don't need an introduction, I'm reminded of being at a conference in Washington about 10 years ago where Henry Kissinger was the main speaker. And the chairman of the event said, if there's anybody in the world who doesn't need an introduction, it's Henry Kissinger, so I give you Dr. Kissinger. Henry got up there and said, you know, I suppose it's true that I would try the German accent, but I'm not good at it. He said, I suppose it's true. I don't need an introduction, but you know, I enjoy a good introduction. Thank you. Thanks to Ambassador Wallace for his vision and his energy and his persistence, which really singularly is the reason the Counter-Extremism Project was formed in the first place last September, and why it's with a great team that he's put together, done so much in the 9 or 10 months since then, and why we are here to expand significantly in partnership with friends like those here at the table in Europe. I want to thank all of you who are here, particularly people from the media. I know there's a lot going on in Brussels, most of it having to do with the problems with the Greek economy. But I suppose the good news and the bad news is that long after the problems of the Greek economy have been solved, the threat of extremism in Europe, the U.S., and around the world will still be something we'll be grappling with. So I suppose I should congratulate those of you who are here and those of you who are listening for taking the longer view. I was very proud to be there at the launch of the Counter-Extremism Project last September in New York. I was because it responds to a painful reality in the world today, which is that the world is awash in blood spilled as a result of brutal, inhumane acts of violence which are committed in the name of extremism. A lot of them, as the three that Mark referred to, France, Tunisia, and Kuwait, were carried out by Islamist extremists, but Islamist extremists have no monopoly on extremism, as we found ourselves in Charleston, South Carolina, just a little more than a week ago, when an extremist, a terrorist, walked into a prayer meeting and killed nine African Americans. This is a global struggle we're involved in. And it is, as you know, a global struggle that is totally unconventional. This is not nation state against nation state only. It is that in part. But it is a nation state sponsoring extremism. It is organization sponsoring extremism. And it is individual, so-called lone wolves, affected either by a religious leader or by via the internet, who are carrying out acts of violence that are brutal and inhumane to a level that in public we have not seen in a long, long time. It seems to me that this very description of the enemy we face, and we all face it, calls for the kind of response that the Counter Extremism Project represents. As I've said, nations, organizations, individuals. This is not a crisis or a challenge that can be solved by governments alone. Governments, particularly through the use of force or other powers that governments uniquely have, play a critical role in this. But we need non-governmental organizations and individuals to be part of this fight, or we will not be successful. And the powerful reality here is that the extremists are a minority. It is those of us who are the counter-extremists in the Muslim community and every other religious community in every country in the world who are the majority. And we have to, in defense of our shared humane values across national boundaries, across religious divides, have to find ways to come together to combat, push back, and ultimately defeat this radical, violent minority that is threatening us. I don't want to repeat what Mark said, but I will say with pride that the CEP, the Counter Extremism Project, has accomplished way more than I thought it would by this time in its history. Mark talked about the work that's done to stop what he appropriately calls the weaponization of the internet, and we particularly focused on Twitter with some very effective results. In terms of disrupting financing, in at least one case, work that the CEP did resulted in a Hezbollah leader being evicted from a particular country because of information CEP provided that country. The third leg is the counter-narrative, the anti-extremist narrative, and in some ways this is the hardest, and in some ways this is why I'm so pleased that we are joining in this partnership with friends and allies in Europe. Roberta Bonazzi, particularly through the European Foundation for Democracy, has been working at this idea of counter-narrative for a decade. How do we break through the stereotypes, the caricatures that inculcate hate and violence? How do we identify individuals, very difficult, who are about to go bad, stop them before law enforcement or state action has to do that. The vision that Mark Wallace had was not an American vision. It was a global, universal vision because, as I said before, we're joined by common values across every seeming divide that those values are being threatened by extremists throughout the world today. And today is a very significant day for us because we're essentially launching this counter-extremism project in Europe, in Brussels, in Berlin, and London as well. And I think we're going to go on from here to other sections of the world where we've already had inquiries to together meet this common enemy. I'm very proud of the people from Europe who are here today to join us. And I would just say, repeat what I said before, we're the majority. The minority is in too many ways successfully inculcating fear in the majority and disrupting the lives of the majority. And what we're all about is providing a future that is more full of peace and freedom in a very personal way for our children and grandchildren and those who follow them. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. And now Roberta Benazzi, the head of the European Foundation for Democracy, and now our CEP Europe partner here in Brussels for a few words. Thank you, Roberta.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Senator. Sorry. Thank you, Senator Lieberman, for the nice words. I'm personally extremely excited about this new initiative and this new partnership. Many of you in this room may know that the European Foundation for Democracy has been working in Brussels for the last 10 years, focusing on issues relating to counter-radicalization, prevention, security, both from Brussels towards the capitals and in a number of member states. The work is extremely complex. The answer that needs to be given is extremely complex and difficult because the issue we're facing is incredibly multifaceted. It's not black and white. And what we've been doing for the past 10 years is trying to understand how the narrative, what kind of narrative is having an impact within communities, and what tools are being used by radical preachers to radicalize, to brainwash, particularly young people. Being able to join forces with colleagues and experts from America and from many other countries in Europe is an incredibly powerful opportunity that we have, precisely because of the complexity of the issue. We have just seen in Mark Wallace, Ambassador Wallace outline the digital disruption campaign and the work that CEP has already been doing for the past months in September. In parallel to this this program, we're going to contribute with or being involved in promoting a new approach towards the counter narrative. When we talk about counter narrative, this is not a new concept. Governments across Europe have been reiterating for the past years, the need to promote a different counter-narrative. What is it, does it exactly mean? This is the most difficult question to answer, particularly because we see that clearly something has not worked. When today we have so many young people fighting, wanting to move towards combat zone, conflict zones like Syria and Iraq, well, we know that something has gone wrong. We have in this room some of our colleagues, Ahmad Mansour, Tufik Bouarfa, who work in France and in Germany on these issues, specifically with communities. They know exactly how preachers, how extremists are not only infiltrating, but taking advantage of the freedoms and the values of our societies. The work that we're launching in promoting a new counter-narrative, and I would say the innovative element of our approach, is that we're working with the educator, the social workers, that level of actors who are at the forefront in seeing changes, in being able to detect changes within young communities or school and classes. And the focus is to educate them and to work with them so that they are able to provide key answers and address the concerns and support individuals in developing the critical thinking that is increasingly necessary or is a fundamental aspect if we want any kind of counter-narratives to have an impact. I'll stop here, and I'll pass the floor to my colleagues on. I would say that the really important and exciting part in this project is the need to work closely together. It's not about America. It's not about Europe. It's not about Germany or France. It's not about Tunisia or Kuwait alone. We're in this battle together, and we need to join forces. Thank you.
Thank you, Roberta. Now it's my pleasure to introduce my good friend and colleague, August Hanning, the former head of the German Intelligence Service, and just incredible knowledge in this area. August, it's great to have you here.
Yes. Thank you very much, Mark. As you have already mentioned, I was the head of the intelligence service in Germany for a long time. Afterwards, I was the deputy minister, we call it in German state secretary, responsible for the internal security in Germany. And therefore, I was and I'm still very familiar with all the threats we are facing. We are looking into the media. Personally, I have witnessed the incident of 9/11, the terrorist attacks in Madrid, London afterwards. Now we are facing continuing threats here in Europe. We have seen this attack in Tunisia and France, and we are under constant threat. That's one point, of course, and that is mainly an issue for the law enforcement agencies, for the intelligence agencies. But on the other side, we have to realize and we have to think over the roots. What are the reasons for this kind of threats? What are the reasons for this drain of young people coming from Europe, going to Daesh, going to Iraq and Syria? What is the reason for young women going in this region? And I think this is a problem which couldn't be solved only by state authorities, by law enforcement agencies, or by intelligence organizations, like Senator Lieberman and Mark have already here told us. I think that is really a task for the society. That is a task for NGOs. We have to think over. And one part of our problem is that I was not only an intelligence officer, I was responsible for the whole demographic questions in Europe. And if you look to the maps and you see the growing Muslim population in Europe, I think this is a constant challenge for all of us to integrate this Muslim community. And we have undertaken a lot of efforts in Germany with the Islam Conference. There are other efforts in other countries of Europe. And now we see the refugee problems. And we are facing more and more refugees from the Middle East, from Libya and from Syria and Iraq. And most of these refugees have a Muslim background. Therefore, I think for us in Europe, but not only in Europe, I think the same applies to the United States, is a huge challenge to integrate these Muslim communities and to do our best not to feed the ground for terrorism, especially threatening young people. And I think a major role playing social media, therefore it's very important, the work which has already been done by CEP in the United States, very successful follow social media, to use social media, and to try our best to prevent young people, young Muslim people, to be, let me say, endangered to be terrorists or to undertake terrorist terror activities and to go to the Middle East and so on and to be a foreign fighter. Therefore, again, I think it's very important to have this effort which is joining us today. And I'm pretty sure that we could achieve a lot together. We could exchange our different views from the United States and inside Europe. And therefore, I think, and I'm pretty convinced that it's a very fruitful effort which has brought us together today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, August. Well, I appreciate your comments. And now I'd ask our colleague, Jiří Šnajder, who is the Deputy Foreign Minister of the Czech Republic, to come up. Very thoughtful and very knowledgeable in the area. Thank you, Jiří, for participating.
Well, you might ask why the Czech is here on this issue, which is not a burning issue for Czech Republic, but believe me or not, it is a burning issue for all of us. You mentioned the risk, the terrorist risk. We share the risk. You mentioned the virtual space as being a theater of various malign operations. We share this. You mentioned the financing of terrorism. We share this problem. We are not cut off this problem. We share all the challenges, and we share the domains where these challenges are. I'm here not as an expert, because I'm not the best expert on the issues you try to research and fight. But I'm here as a citizen who is who cares about the society and here in Europe. I was catapulted into political life when Václav Havel was elected the president of Czechoslovakia. I'm out of generation which attached a lot of hopes to becoming a part of Europe. And now I see a lot of challenges which are antagonizing European societies and polarizing it. I see a great challenge of a backlash from what we have achieved. So that's why I'm very glad I was invited to be part of this project, and I would love my young colleagues to be part of the research and also the communities in this part of Europe, being part of the sharing of experience of the best practices from the communities in other countries. So thank you very much for having me aboard.
Thank you, Yuri. And now it's my pleasure to call up to our podium my friend Mark Simmons, who has recently become liberated from government and is no longer a sitting MP, but is now thankfully helping us with our European organization of the Counter Extremism Project. Mark.
Well, as Mark has just explained, I was until recently a UK Foreign Office minister who had responsibility for, amongst other things, some of the challenges in the responses that the UK government had put forward to the particular challenges of security to British citizens elsewhere, which I think has been underscored by the terrible tragic events that we've recently seen in Tunisia. And obviously in the United States, Kuwait, and France. There are just three very quick points I wish to make. The first is to thank Ambassador Wallace and his team for the very significant progress that has been made on the Counter-Extremism Project in a very short space of time. And it's a huge privilege and pleasure for me to be part of a very exciting, dynamic, and well-informed team to bring expertise from both the United Kingdom, but also from elsewhere in Europe, to plug into the expertise that exists in the United States, to work as a team to provide both counter-narrative and policy architecture to assist governments and other organisations around the world. There are three particular areas that I think we should be focusing on. The first is the counter-narrative, particularly that relates to the challenges in the United Kingdom we face. There are, for example, 65 different statutory provisions, 600 separate public bodies dealing with the threat of extremism and terrorism. And for those who follow these things, you'll be aware of the recent Anderson report that has been produced in the United Kingdom that recommends pulling and reducing those number of statutory provisions and bodies into a much pithier and more focused legislative structure. And I very much hope that the Counter-Extremism Project can provide some advice and advocacy into dealing with that. The second area I just want to very quickly mention is, why is the Counter-Extremism Project so important? One of the facets that I learned as a government minister is we need to use all the expertise that exists, whether it be in government, the private sector, not-for-profit, charitable organisations, voluntary organisations, and the communities, to pull together to develop a cohesive strategy, because there is a natural distrust of government and government organisations. The police perhaps is the most obvious example, and we need to reach disenfranchised communities and populations and those who have little respect for Western governments. We also need to join up our effort by work pulling together, pulling the best ideas from all different areas, and this requires a cohesive strategy, not just lobbying governments, but also communities and working from the ground level up. And the PREVENT strategy in the United Kingdom is something that, again, I hope the Counter Extremism Project will be able to work towards. We need a comprehensive strategy, whether it be education through counter-narrative, diplomacy, sanctions, intelligence, law enforcement, social media, military force where appropriate, and of course, economic development. And the reason why I was very enthusiastic to get involved in this organisation is that I believe we are stronger together than we are apart.
Thank you all very much, and we'll be taking some questions in a minute, but I do want to talk for a moment about the young people and the teams of people behind this. It's so important. For the last generation, 25 years or so, extremist groups have used the internet and their own networking to expand their reach so that ISIS can reach into internet cafes around the corner from this press club into my neighborhood in New York. But what we haven't done is united as countries and united as private citizens to push back and use the tools at our disposal to fight against extremism. And it's been an incredible experiment and experience, frankly, for me to see all of our young people. David Ibsen is the executive director of the Counter Extremism Project. He's here. John Duhigg is here from the European Foundation. Is here. We have young people like Nicole Flatteron, who's been so experienced on the Twitter and on a variety of social media. Darlene Kayabyab, Stephen Cohen, op-ed, you're here. We have so many people. Lorenzo Vedino is here from George Washington. Thank you for coming. I know you were in town. Thank you for coming to that. But it will require a variety of different people with a variety of different cultural backgrounds from a variety of different places to bring the expertise that they have and unite it across the best practices across Europe, the United States, and the world, and use those best practices tailored to the countries in which they live. We think that that is the model that has to succeed as coalitions are forming in governments now to deal with this. We think that the private sector has to have a similar coalition. And that's what you've seen come about today. Imagine as we engage in trying to knock off the cyber jihadi who uses Twitter as a weapon, if we can do that in the United States, in France, Germany, in multiple languages, so that we can prevent those that would seek to turn the internet into a weapon of hate, to prevent that from happening, or at least minimize its effect. That's what we hope to do by one example. With that, I want to offer up time for any questions that we have, and just remind the group here that we will be doing a Twitter question and answer session at 3 o'clock today with me, Dr. Hanning, Senator Lieberman, that should be even in more detail. With that, I'd be happy to field any questions and distribute them across an incredibly distinguished group. So thank you all very much for coming, and we look forward to any questions you have. Please. Could you say it a little louder?
Christian Nielsen from Chronicle.
Yeah.
I'm quite curious as to how you actually do counter it on Twitter. I mean, it's a fairly immediate medium, unless you hit it more or less as and when you see it. The chances of it having an effect are lower, I suppose. So how do you agree on the messaging beforehand, or is it 100% going local? You let the local operator formulate the appropriate response. So something more concrete, if you can reveal that.
Absolutely. We've had some real concrete examples to date, and of course I'd like my colleagues to chime in as appropriate, but what you've seen in the case of ISIS, we'll use ISIS as an example because regrettably they've been known to tweet something like 90 to 100,000 tweets per day. The most main active ISIS accounts we view as the seed accounts of the ISIS accounts, and we've engaged in systematic revelation of the identities of those accounts, contacting Twitter, alerting government authorities to try to remove those Twitter accounts as expeditiously as we can. To the extent that you can remove a propagandist, recruiter, or somebody that calls for a lone wolf terror attack, you're doing something significant. Now, there's been a lot of discussion as to how effective that is. I recently had the privilege of testifying before my United States Congress about the issue. And one of the terms that was used is it's like whack-a-mole, where you hit in one spot and the jihadi can come up in another spot in Twitter. It's not true. As many of you know, if you have a Twitter account, you have a number of followers. Every time you take a cyber jihadi off of a social media platform, they come back, if they do come back, much weaker. And if you are persistent, you make it much harder for them to act. So each one that you reveal and remove, you are degrading the ability of a terrorist organization or an extremist organization of spreading its hateful message, calling to action, recruiting, and maybe even fundraising. We've seen it in a very specific example, a regrettable example. There's a man by the name of Mujahid Miski, who was a Minneapolis, Somali-born Minneapolis resident that ostensibly fled to Somalia, although he's been suggested that he's in other locations. He was one of the internet's leading propagandists for ISIS. Because of our efforts, we successfully removed him from Twitter over and over again. Even more regrettably, however, it was revealed that the two lone wolf actors that targeted the hateful people in Texas that were mocking the Prophet Muhammad, that were who attempted a terrorist attack in Garland, Texas, were inspired by Miski. He had multiple accounts on Twitter. Ultimately, he was taken off Twitter because of our efforts of law enforcement, and exposing him. Our goal is to expose and reveal as many of these internet propagandists as we can that are spreading hate and calling to action. And to the extent that we can do that in multiple languages across continents, I think we'll be doing something.
So for the counter-narrative, I mean, how do the operators literally handle it? Do they get into an exchange with these people at all? Or is it, well, let's say, at the preparatory stage, is not someone who's already
The question that you pose for the purpose of the rest of the audience, how do you deal with counter-narrative? Counter-narrative just isn't just, and we shouldn't suggest that it can be accomplished by individual tweets. I think that what you've seen is of all the areas, the governments and NGOs have fallen behind. You know, when you look at the tools, counter-narrative is the biggest one. The 12-ton gorilla in the room of how do you thoughtfully push back on a hateful ideology. And I don't think you should take any of our comments to suggest that we will just be engaging in a 140-character pushback on counter-narrative. I think that's unserious. You will see, and I think you see my government in the United States, the European Union, individual countries within the European Union, develop multi-tiered strategies to make sure that tolerance, counter-extremism lessons, not becoming vulnerable, identifying ways to ensure that young people can resist the alluring call of some of these jihadis is spread across a multi-tiered platform. I think stay tuned. You'll be seeing a lot of broader announcements coming out both from the United States and the European Union. Our own experience, and Roberta can speak to this, is that what's very important is that local communities want to hear from local leaders, whether it be elected leaders, faith leaders, community leaders, and that is the most effective way right now in talking to those that are vulnerable to it. But I think stay tuned for more organized, broader efforts you see coming out of the United States and the European Union. You saw the start of the discussions of some of those tactics at President Obama's counter-extremism summit, which we participated in a few months back.
Mark, let me just add, real brief to end on both points. When I was chairman of the Senate Homeland Security Committee, we followed the internet and noticed a very significant number of YouTube videos that were really jihadist. They were inciting violence. So we decided to ask a young member of our staff. I'm laughing because together with Lorenzo Seamus Hughes, which is his name, have now started a center on counterterrorism at George Washington University. How about that for a plug? Anyway, he spent his time following these YouTubes. And Google, which owns YouTube, has a really quite remarkable system where you probably a lot of you know about it. You file a complaint, they'll check it. They have standards that they've adopted. And if they determine that it violates those standards, which is to say it's not just free speech, but it's inciting violence, they'll take it down. Now, you do have the whack-a-mole problem.
But at least you've got them on the run, and you can come back and get them again. The second thing I'll say about the counter-narrative, and I think we all agree, that we haven't really gotten this right yet. It's very hard. But the fact that we're reaching to this makes this important point about the war, if I can use that metaphor we're in. It's not just, it's a war of ideas. It's a war of ideology. It's a war of theology. That's what's motivating the extremists who are randomly killing people. And ultimately, we're not going to win this war without winning the war of ideas, ideology, and theology. And that's what we're reaching for in what we're calling the counter-narrative part of our work.
Roberta, do you?
Yeah. I'd like to add on the counter-narrative. As has been said, it's extremely complex, extremely difficult. One of the reasons why we are moving towards supporting and working with the level of educators and social workers is because we found out, and please feel free to ask questions to our German and French colleagues, we realized that young people constantly have questions. And unless you have educators who are able to give intelligent questions without being afraid of being accused of anything, but intelligence questions that support the critical thinking of young people, they go to someone else who's going to give them answers. And very often the ones who are most ready to give these kind of answers are radicals, not always from the mosque, but they are. And we see there's so many stories, there's so many cases. Please do feel free to ask our colleagues for some very specific examples, and then you'll understand what we're talking about.
Other questions?
Thank you. Yeah, John Kapstein, American Freelance. Two questions. One is, what's the source of financing for the organization, your own organization? And two, perhaps more importantly, when you're dealing with organized extremism, how successful are you in finding the channels of financing, and what can you do about it?
Sure. Let me start. The Counter Extremism Project is formed just like any other great American charity, as a 501c3. It's an arcane part of the American tax code. And typically, and many times, 501c3 not-for-profits keep their donors confidential, particularly when they're contributing to an effort that deals with terrorism or difficult states. We value security and safety, frankly, of our donors over making them known to the public, so we keep them confidential, as you can imagine. All private individuals who view these things as very, very important, and we're hoping to solicit and identify individuals around the world that would want to contribute to this cause, and keeping them confidential, we think, keeps them safe, because the risks of lone wolf terror attacks, I think, is quite great. And your second question, excuse me?
The second question is, how successful are you in finding channels of finance for organized extremism, and what can you do about it? What are you doing?
In the three buckets that we think that we will work in, which is first, revealing terror financing, the second, really, on the cyber jihad part, if you will, and then third, the counter-narrative, there has been a generation of effort of those that have engaged in sanctions, terrorist financing work, and we're privileged to work with some of the brightest minds in that area. Already, we've tried to disrupt ISIS oil sales, for example, and a variety of other funding mechanisms that Daesh has used in the region to fund their activities. We have focused on the likes of Hezbollah, Hamas, and a variety of other terror groups. We're even looking into how far right in the United States supports those that would engage in the propaganda that led to the attacks in Charleston, South Carolina. So I think we have a lot of experience. We've assembled a team that is very experienced in that area, and we already have some tangible fruit that has been born out of those efforts. So stay tuned to see more, but I think that the terror financing part is very well developed. It's a small community, if you look globally, of those that are expert in terror financing. We're really lucky to have some of the best experts, and already we've had some significant victories. The Gambian government threw out a designated terrorist out of Gambia that was a Hezbollah financier and used the Gambian economy as a money laundering operation, was a recent success of the Counter Extremism Project. And Mark?
Can I just add to the point that Ambassador Wallace has made? There's a huge amount of work that's being done. both through CEP but also from government to governments, to build capacity, particularly for those governments who have less experience and expertise in this area, to make sure that they are not they have sufficient protection so they don't become an attractive place to launder money for terrorism. And it's not just the obvious places. So there are a number, for example, of African governments who are looking very closely at the flows of money that are going through their central banks and individual banks to make sure that it's not terrorism finance that's going through those banks, but legitimate business resources.
Thank you. Droni Alasson, I'm a Kurdish journalist from the Middle East Diplomatic. I have been busy with this question, you know, many years, especially this, you know, the last 1 year. I have always wondered who and how they could organize so many people who had, you know, the potential to be terrorists, organize so short time, thousands of people, bring them to Syria and Iraq to fight. First question. Second, if the European intelligence services, security forces, or whatever institutions was flowing those people via email, tweet, I don't know, Facebook, and this and that, or the other ways, the telephone communication as well, why they let those people well run to the Syria so easy to fight, especially we Kurds, we are suffering today 1,500 kilometers to Delhi and Iraq.
Let me start. I'm sure many of my colleagues have great experience in that. Obviously, maybe you can handle that one. But the one point that we should make is literally governments and private citizens and NGOs are playing catch up. We have really stuck our head in the sand while terrorists have used the tools of modern finance and modern communication to advance their narrative. In Europe, has dealt with terrorism for many, many years. Many terrorist groups were unsuccessful, but the modern terrorists now, out of the Middle East and otherwise, are successfully weaponizing social media, communicating to reach into places that they were unable to reach before. Frankly, who knows if terrorists of the 60s and 70s and even 80s had the tools of mass communication, if they too would not have been able to have been successful in expanding. Regrettably, governments, both individually and together, have not paid attention to that spread and the ability of terrorists to harness social media and communication skills to spread their message and to recruit people. Now, the numbers are still on a relative basis to the large numbers of people in Belgium, for example, but they are still large enough to cause enormous suffering, pain, carnage, and terrorism. We have to push back on both that narrative. We have to use to fight them on the internet to make sure that they can't spread those messages. We have to shut down accounts. The social media companies must do more. Twitter is a good example. You see many companies have acted in a very collaborative manner. Twitter, we think, has not done enough. Only recently have they put in even a policy regarding extremism. It still doesn't go far enough. And we are looking to work collaboratively with a lot of the social media companies to do much, much more. For many years, for some time, Twitter, for example, took the position that one man's freedom fighter was another man's terrorist in response to any actor. I don't think any of us views the horrible and horrific acts that we're seeing coming out of ISIS as a freedom fighter. These are the most heinous of terrorists, and Twitter, like other companies, has a responsibility to do much, much more. But, you know, maybe August, you could speak to the foreign fighter issue and the challenges that you had when you sort of...
Especially how they was organized so in a short time, and how easy they went inside of Syria.
Yeah. First of all, social media
play a very important role.
Like Mark has already expressed. And we see all these videos from their terrorist activities, but they are very active in other fields. And for the first time, Daesh tries to establish their own state. I think that's very, very new. And they are providing healthcare, they are providing services, and they are very attractive for many Muslim, young Muslim in Europe, because they see, oh, for the first time, there is not only an organization, but Daesh is trying really to establish their own state. And that makes them attractive, not only for foreign fighters, but for engineers, for other young Muslims who try to help and to build up new states according to the rules of the Quran. That's the one point. The other point, there are well organized. There are structures in Turkey and elsewhere who are organizing all these trips, and it is very very easy to go from Germany to Turkey. The German authorities and the authorities in other countries in Europe as well, they try their best to prevent these young people to go to Turkey, but via Turkey to Iraq or Syria. Most of them are crossing the border from Turkey to Iraq and Syria. But of course, you have to identify at first if you want to try to prevent them to go to Turkey. Many of them are not identified in advance. And I was last weekend in Turkey, and I've asked the Turkish Minister for Foreign Affairs the same question, how it is possible that so many people are crossing the border from Turkey to Iraq and Syria. And he told me, oh, it's very difficult to control the border. Yes, that's right. On the other side, we see, I try to be a little bit cautious, that the attitude of the Turkish government sometimes was a little bit ambiguous, because, you know, these foreign fighters, they are supporting Daesh, and Daesh is one of the main enemies of Assad, and the Turkish government is not very friendly towards the Assad regime. I don't want to explain it in detail, you know. And therefore, my impression is on the other side that the Turkish government now is changing this attitude, and they are looking more into these structures who are organizing the smuggling of young people, foreign fighters from Europe to Iraq and in Syria. The other point, coming back to this questions of financing Daesh, I think that is really a very difficult issue, because we have weak states, weak regions. We see North Iraq, the Kurdish regions there, and there's a lot of smuggling on the one side. On the other side, they get some subsidies from neighboring states for the same reasons why the Turkish government was a little bit ambiguous. Because these ISIS, Daesh is fighting against Assad, and you know Assad is in some states in the region not very popular. I think that is a very mixed picture what we have, but I agree with you, in the end of the day we have to find out who is really financing these organizations. We should identify it, and really we should do our utmost to prevent young people coming from Europe to cross the border via Turkey to Syria and Iraq, and I think we have made some progress during the last months and years.
Please.
About counter-narratives, I'm Shiraz, I'm from Pakistan. I've followed extremism, rise of extremism in my country. What I see is that the mechanism of brainwashing, making a child into an extremist, starts with disconnecting that child from womanhood, and then disconnecting the child from the local indigenous cultural expressions. It is very vital to disconnect a person from the ground, from the earth, local cultural expressions, their womanhood, their local relationships, even relationships with the family, with their own parents. Does this element in your project, do you realize this, or are you doing something for this? I see this in diasporas also, totally cut off from the cultural expressions, from their real soulful expression. Do you realize this? Do you do something about, do you have this aspect in your mind?
Yes, and I certainly allow our panelists, but you're right. And one of our focus, and stay tuned in some of the things that we'll be hopefully announcing in the near future, we believe that not only is it disconnecting, but young people are an important part of this. And communicating with young people while honoring traditions and supporting those traditions is key. Otherwise, people lose their identity and are susceptible to those that would try to brainwash or bring them into a ideology that is so insidious. So we see that across the board. And that's one of the reasons why the Counter Extremism Project is formed as it is. It would be preposterous for me as an American former diplomat to come into a Pakistani immigrant community in Brussels and suggest to you how to not be susceptible to the insidious call to action by Daesh. What we need is local community leaders, local leaders with an experience here to speak, elevate those cultural identities, and keep them strong. That's the best way to counter this. Now, the key is how do you create a global mechanism to ensure that those messages are always heard and felt. Roberta, you do this every day.
I'll go back to the importance of the Counter Extremism Project and having brought together so many different individuals and experts and organizations, precisely because there's not one single answer. You raise a good point. How do you deal with the local community, with the individuals? Well, we're not here to say we have the answer that applies and works for everybody across Europe and wherever necessary. But we're working with experts on the ground who understand, have a better understanding of how different dynamics play in each country, because every country is different. And within the same country, you have different communities that have different needs and priorities.
Senator Lieberman?
So 2 points quickly. One, first of all, I think your statement is very important, very insightful. And this question of disconnection has been practiced by totalitarian regimes for a long time, disconnecting from family, community. I mean, perhaps the most extreme version of it now is practiced by the North Koreans. The second thing is that you describe something very real. It goes directly to the so-called lone wolf problem in countries like the U.S., are throughout Europe, and it's happening more and more in the U.S. that acts of violence are being carried out by individuals. They may have been affected by something on the internet. They may have, in essence, been disconnected by the internet, but they're essentially invisible to law enforcement. And here's where ultimately the government needs the help of people. In this sense, you know, there was a campaign that started in New York, a counter-extremism, counter-terrorism campaign called See Something, Say Something. That was really about objects. See, you see a backpack left in Times Square alone, immediately tell the policeman. It may just be a backpack that somebody forgot, but it could be a bomb. Really, in these cases, we have to ask, and it happens some, we're trying to create this more and more in vulnerable communities in the U.S. You have to rely on family members and close friends to say, so-and-so, our relative, our friend, seems to be disconnecting from us. We're worried about him, and come in and help. Now, hopefully the help in the first instance is not law enforcement. It's some attempt to provide a counter-narrative and bring that person back from extremism and violence.
Key point, please.
Do you think it's for all your best efforts, impossible to really stop the sort of lone wolf attacks that we see, for instance, in Tunisia? Are they almost inevitable? That's the first one. Second one, could I just have a bit more detail from maybe Roberta about the efforts, just briefly, on targeting those, such as you call educators, social workers, and community leaders who have the ability to influence young people. What's a bit more detail on that, exactly what you mean by that, what you're going to do. And thirdly, briefly again, could Muslim leaders, do you think, Muslim community leaders be doing more themselves to sort of join in the narrative that you're talking about?
Sure, why don't I take the first part, Roberta the second, and the senator perhaps, and anybody else that'd like to chime in. Look, the lone wolf attack is, I think, most security chiefs, diplomats around the world will say, is something that keeps everyone awake at night. There's a real threat. I want to hearken back to another time in Europe. I was talking to a former Italian diplomat recently. We were talking about the Red Army faction, Red Brigades. These were insidious groups that were caused a lot of harm, and they killed people, prominent people. They certainly haven't had the reach and the killing and terroristic effect of these of the likes of ISIS. Imagine if the Red Brigades, who used to hand out those flyers, dating myself and others in the room, with the red stars on pamphlets. Imagine if they had the internet at the time and were savvy tweeters, had savvy Facebook accounts and the like. Perhaps they would have been able to extend their reach much farther. What we're seeing now is that lone wolf attacks, people can reach into our neighborhoods from thousands of miles away from now what is effectively the caliphate. Granted, it's still in flux, but there's a terrorist homeland, and there's a vigorous social networking campaign coming out of the country, reaching into an internet cafe in every one of our neighborhoods, potentially radicalizing and calling to act people in our neighborhoods. We have to degrade their ability to spread that cyber jihad. You should think of a Twitter account in the hands of the likes of some of these jihadis as no different than any other weapon, an AK-47, a knife, a bomb. These people are effectively using the internet as a weapon. We need to shut that down, fight it, knock them off of the internet, ensure that the internet companies come up with policies and procedures that don't allow them to weaponize as weapons. And frankly, if the internet companies don't do enough here, or in my country, or in other countries, at some point, turning a blind eye becomes material support. You cannot have a social media company that says, oh, it's okay, we'll just let the public forum sort this out. The internet companies do enormous work preventing the likes of child pornography, stalking in the case of stalking and abuse in the case of women and the like. They need to do much more in the case of extremists, because we need to prevent the spread of these lone wolf attacks. And those lone wolf attacks are frankly inspired by the likes of jihadis who are using computers to reach in and plot lone wolf attacks, help plot lone wolf attacks around the world. Roberta, do you want to talk about the second part?
On the counter-narrative program, reaching educators. In Germany, our colleague Ahmad Mansour and his team have been briefing and working with school teachers, social workers for the past 2 years. They are able to reach up to hundreds a month. In France, we've started launching or defining the program with a technical school, so that the goal is that we can include this series of the new curriculum in the new school year starting in September. Certainly what needs to be done is implement this kind of work in a systematic way, provide them and give them a tool that is a number of different tools, ranging from the explaining and like training them on how to deal with the questions that are being raised, but also putting together a handbook that they can use on a daily basis for their work.
Let me just add one point, if I could, to that. A month ago, the White House, President Obama, and his National Security Council had sponsored an event bringing in universities and students from all over the world. It was called Peer-to-Peer, Countering Violent Extremism. And it was effectively a contest of inviting young people, the people that can best effectively speak to young people, or young people, to identify platforms to convey to young people around the world the dangers of extremism and to preach tolerance. And ultimately, I was honored to be a judge of this contest in partnership with the White House. And the winning school was Missouri State University. And they came up with a program that focused on bringing curriculum and curriculums of tolerance and countering extremism to young people, millennials, ages 9 to 15, to ensure that we don't continue to lose generations to those that would preach hate. And I think that the White House is very enthusiastic, and hopefully with international partners, about supporting efforts just like that around the world to reach out to young people, to no longer allow there to be a silence in the face of those that would twist ideology in the minds of young people. Senator, I'm sorry I jumped in there.
No, not at all. So the question is, what is the role of leadership in the Muslim community as part of the counter-narrative? And I would say it is critically necessary. It is not the cure all. I mean, to some extent, young people who may be vulnerable to extremist ideas may not find some of the leaders in their own community to be credible. On the other hand, It has to help, particularly from religious leaders, because so much of the motivation that inspires extremism and violence in the name of extremism seems to be theological, and there needs to be, from credible religious leaders, a powerful counter-argument, which is the truth, which is what these violent extremists are doing, who happen to be Muslim, is not what Islam is about. And so I would say that's important. You've got some fascinating examples of it, hopeful. I mean, one to me is Sheikh Ghannouchi in Tunisia, who is in a sense the spiritual and political leader of the party there, Ennahda. And he's tried very hard to play that role in Tunisia. There's no 100% guarantees here. That's the, when you're dealing with lone wolves, you're trying to create an environment in which the stimuli to violence and extremism will be diminished or counteracted. It's very hard to stop at 100%.
And that's been a big focus of efforts in cities around the world. In Minneapolis, we have a large Somali community, and local imams there have stood up and tried to use their persuasive capabilities when families grow concerned about a potential radicalization of a young person in that family. Imams have been an enormous part of the solution, as even still, there have been some difficulties out of that community. But we're seeing partnerships like that, because the reality is, in a community, a local community, if you are a family member and you are concerned about a relative that might be radicalizing, your first call can't be the security services, because that's not going to be your first call. It should be to local leaders, community leaders, spiritual leaders, and the like. And whether it's preachers, in the case of far-right radicalism that we see on the far right in our country, or imams across the world, they have to be a large part of the solution in dealing with local community outreach. August, I didn't mean to cut you off. You were about to jump in.
I just want to make one additional remark. If you are discussing these problems with leaders of Muslim communities, you will very often hear the reaction that has nothing to do with Islam. All this is crimes, and we in the Muslim world, we are ourselves victims of the terrorist attacks. Yes, that's right. But they don't want to take over responsibility. And I was in the security conference in Moscow, and the delegate from Abu Dhabi was very angry and said, "Here we hear about Islamistic terrorism. It's not Islamistic, it has nothing to do with Islam. We are Islamophobic, and so on." I think that's a difficult question. On the other side, all these terrorist attacks are in the name of Islam, and therefore I think, yes, the Muslim community, they have to take over a responsibility, but it is sometimes a very difficult question. And I think I can only agree with Mark and Senator Nimmerman. I think, yes, they have a special responsibility, and they should really be addressed by our efforts.
I want to just say something here. Why the Islamic communities, countries don't organize
Well, first of all, yeah.
I think it's time for you to stop being a journalist and start being an activist and organizer. I think you're ready.
Well, I think you've seen, you know, with respect, you've seen a lot of progress, and you know, the events of the last few years have inspired a lot of action. I spent a lot of time traveling around the region. And I sense a sea change. I sense a lot of the countries, Muslim countries, and their leaders want to participate and are trying to find innovative solutions. You've seen the Hidayah Center out of Abu Dhabi. You've seen the Saudis contribute large sums of money to the UN Counterterrorism Center. You've seen a variety of efforts across the board. Is it enough yet? No. This is a growing problem. But I do sense a change, and it would be folly for us to assume that we can accomplish this ourselves. We have to rely on partners across the world to do this.
Mark, can I just make one additional point in the response to the question that we're discussing, which is I think that not just CEP, but across the board for all of those organisations, including governments who are engaged in this particular issue, we need to find mechanisms to both understand and then publicize mainstream Muslim public opinion, which is against what is being perpetrated in the name of Islam. And therefore, there needs to be a much greater understanding of some of the Islamic community's views, and I think a much greater dissemination of those views to the broader public. Because I think in the United Kingdom, there is some ignorance about the breadth and the variety of views in the Islamic community. And the danger is, of course, that people will perceive Islamic extremism as mainstream Islam. And of course, we all know in this room that it's not, but we need to find mechanisms of disseminating that to the broader public.
Roberta?
Along this line, one of the projects we developed a few years ago was to build a network of European Muslim citizens, and I stress European Muslim citizens, so individuals who are first of all European, they happen to be Muslims in the same way as others can belong to other religions, but the what united them was the fact that they felt equally concerned and worried by the spread of the ideology. And what is interesting about this network was that, of course, naively maybe, let me say, we started, my colleague and I approached this project by saying, thinking, okay, they're Muslim, they're, we need to bring them together. In fact, they didn't feel Muslim. They were, their level of integration was that they're like, why should I say something? Yes, I happen to be Muslim, but I'm an individual, so we have to be very careful, and we're always very careful in how we deal with these issues and how we engage with people, because most of them have become our friends, and we struggle, like, would I go out and speak as a Christian because crimes have been committed by Christians? No, I wouldn't, because I'm an individual first of and foremost. So that's something we've been, yeah.
And this isn't a debate. To be clear, extremism takes many forms. Right now, my country is going through a debate on the Confederate flag and on far-right extremism. And I was watching an interview, and Senator Lieberman can relate to this as well, where a prominent Southerner had advised President Obama when he came to eulogize one of the souls that was lost in the Charleston shooting to not bring up the issue of the Confederate flag, that the Southerners and the Southern leaders had to bring this up, who had the experience of the Confederate flag. I was glad that the president brought it up. But you see the debate. Southerners in the southern states and community leaders are all debating about how to best do away with the Confederate flag as a symbol of those who view it as a symbol of slavery and racism. And you see that debate taking place, and that debate is taking place in the South, and it's hard for people outside that region of the United States to more easily engage in that debate. And that's the same thing that's happening in different extremist communities around the world. So in many ways, particular Muslim communities that are at risk are going to be best communicated to and have the best dialogue with other Muslims. It's very hard, I think, for people that are viewed as outside of that community to come in and preach to them. The first solution has to be community leaders, I think, across the board, whatever form of extremism. Next question, please, in the back.
Thank you. I'm Nagayo Taniguchi from Japanese media. Senator Lieberman, the United States has taken initiative of this global coalition against ISIL. I guess it was from September last year. How complementary is your endeavor, Counter Extremist Project, could be with this coalition? And if there are any, according to your view, any weaknesses in this mechanism of concept of this coalition in order to be more stable and robust institution to deter such a rise of all these sorts of dangerous destabilization across the world?
Thanks for the question. It's a very important and interesting question. So the bottom line answer is that I think what the Global Coalition Against ISIS is trying to do militarily is complemented by what the Counter-Extremism Project is doing in perhaps the most direct sense, that we're trying to cut off the flow of volunteers through the counter-narrative to ISIS, and also to cut off financing, to disrupt their financing channels. I mean, I'll just say very briefly that I'm speaking personally now. I think that what's happened in Syria and Iraq is a very powerful lesson for the world. We stood back, and I'm talking about the United States, when we stood back in Syria when the first uprisings occurred against the Assad government. And I spent a fair amount of time meeting with the people who were in the first group of rebels, if you will, freedom fighters, and I reached the conclusion these were not extremists. These were patriots. They were simply trying to retake their government from a brutal dictator. And we left them alone for too long. We gave them a lot of lip service. What ultimately happened, of course, is Iran came in strongly for Assad. Other extremist groups, much more violent and antagonistic to our values, finally including ISIS, came in. And the same happened in Iraq when we pulled back. And as a result, we're facing, for the first time, not just an Islamist extremist group, but one who, as it happens, a year ago today, declared a caliphate. This is what we all worried about, theorized, speculated on, predicted, but here it was. But it's not too late, and I appreciate the leadership that the U.S. is giving to that global coalition. We can't be half-hearted about it, because the ISIS is not half-hearted about it. I will tell you this, you probably know it. Not so long ago, maybe a year and a half or 2 years ago, I and a lot of other Americans were worried about what might be called a neo-isolationism growing within both major political parties in the United States. Pull back from the world. And that all changed. In part, it changed when Russia took Crimea, and part it changed because of some of the aggressiveness that China is showing in the Asia Pacific. But really, the ultimate moment of change was when ISIS beheaded people, and it was a moment when the American people said, "This is just unacceptable. It's unacceptable to the extreme. This is it's happening now over there, but unless we stop it, it's going to happen everywhere." And so the country is very supportive, I think, of the actions that the president has taken against ISIS, and I believe would be supportive of yet more because we feel threatened by them.
Please. Yes, Rasim Brahim from SFU newspaper. Actually, I have a cell phone question. Do you have that?
No. Yeah. No, please.
Did you have time for 1,000 the question?
1,000 questions? Probably not that many.
Sorry.
We have the internet, though. You can.
If it's possible to ask it, I mean, one after one. I have just three questions for Mr. Hennig. Dr. August, you mentioned very important topic, and it's very linked to you. I mean, the problem of integrating the Muslim community, and you referred that it's increasing. Some reports suggested 10% to 2050. Mr. August, you know when a state announces a project, like building a building or something, so they are responsible. And at the end, the final result of this, if this project failed, this building collapsed, so the main responsibility is the state. So all these integration programs announced by the European states, if it's failed, it's a responsibility of who? Taking in consider that the Chancellor Merkel, and after that, Mr. David Cameron announced that this multi-culti community is built. So if you want to revisit this strategy of integration, what's the main wrong steps you would correct?
In Germany, you see a lot of mosques which have been built during the last years. I think normally it's not really raising serious difficulties in neighborhoods if you